Today, he will share with you the burning question, why digital? Ladies and gentlemen, will you please put your hand together for the simply awesome Mr. Ricardo Ottolenghi.
Thank you everybody for joining us. Why digital is the question of the day. And what I'd like to do is take you through a little bit of a journey, because it's been a little bit of a personal journey that I encountered myself. So who's your speaker today? That's me. I've been actually in Asia for about 3 years, coming from a professional life developed mostly in London. I've been a management consultant most of my life, advising clients on a number of strategic issues. And there was a time in my life where I actually came to realize that I had to understand what digital is. So I was probably sitting where you guys are today and really scratching my head trying to understand these SEO, SEM, and when the missile would finally hit me. And that's when I actually decided to join ControlShift and lead the digital revolution. So I do sympathize a lot, and I hope that we will have this meeting of minds today, and will be very, very happy after my presentation to just sit down with you and answer any questions that you might have, because I do understand the subject can be daunting. So daunting that some people might even think is like reaching to the moon. And it is really a market that is moving so fast that trying to get there in that digital space can be a logistical nightmare in as much as an intellectual challenge. But make no mistake, we are in the very first minutes of the digital revolution. So there is far, far more to happen. And what is really driving all this big trend into digital? Why suddenly everybody's gone digital crazy? Well, let's take a step back to see what is happening. Really, technology is driving all of this. So when people went to the moon about 50 years ago, they were carrying these things. So this was the actual computer on board of the Apollo 11 that took the first man to the moon. This machine was about 70 pounds heavy. It was about 11 years old baby that was doing a blindingly fast speed of 64, not even a megahertz speed, and he had 64 kilobytes of memory. That's pretty much a little bit more memory than I have. And now let's fast track to a few years back. Now we've got this. This fits in your pocket. It's got a 1 gigabyte of memory, and that's far more memory than I have. And it's got a blindingly fast processor. So you can understand that if we took a man to the moon with the computer 50 years ago, today we all carry supercomputers. And the power of these machines, that's fundamentally changing our lives. Because this is what digital is all about. Whether you want it or not as a business, your customers' lives are changing. And how are they changing? Basically, they access a phenomenal amount of information, and they use the digital and the online space to do all sorts of things. So newspapers are no longer part of the equation. In fact, they are a small part of the equation. Tablets, phones, computers have taken over our lives, and we interact with those. We interact with reality through our phones on a constant basis. There are, particularly in Asia, the mobile landscape is booming. Mobile is actually the biggest driver of this digital adoption. And the Economist Intelligence Unit has forecasted that 4.3 billion mobile connections will exist by 2019. And that's a lot of connections. That's a lot of eyeballs constantly looking at the phone. Some people have estimated that people look at their phone 1,500 times a day. And they start looking at their phone in the morning. That's a study they've done in the UK. The average user picks up the phone the first time at 7:31 in the morning. That's on average. Sounds familiar? I know how to do it. So let's just do a survey, a very quick survey. How many people carry one device? Okay, majority. How many people carry two devices? Okay, good. How many people carry three devices? Okay, four devices? Oh, four devices. There are support groups for people with four devices. So, but you do understand the role that this technology is playing in our lives. And what do people do? What do Malaysians do? Actually, Malaysia is one of the countries, one of five countries, that has taken a huge leap forward in terms of using smartphones to do pretty much everything. From flagging a taxi to ordering your chicken rice, they've been doing all sorts of activities with your phone. But specifically, social has taken over search. So people are really, really socializing with each other. And they're using social to do what? To influence each other. Because the reality is that if you look at social from a business perspective, that's your biggest opportunity to influence your customers. Then, of course, we've got the usual search. There are videos on YouTube, the famous cat videos that everybody's watching. And then there is a whole host of entertainment. Pretty much 0.5% of the people do that on their smartphone. They don't use desktop anymore. They don't use the newspaper anymore. They do that on their smartphones. So they listen to music, they play games, and quite interesting, 44% of the people will go online before making a purchase decision in Malaysia. And that's quite high. That's actually much higher than in the UK. In the UK, it's about 21%. And what do they buy? Do they just buy books and stuff like that? No. Fridges, televisions, virtually big household goods will go there. And I guarantee you that a lot of your customers, once they see your advertising on the newspaper, they will go online to check their property out online. So, going on, in the region, this is the case of Indonesia. Digital has taken so much such an important role in our life that people tend to have more Facebook than bank accounts. 50% of Indonesians have Facebook, but only 20% have a bank account, just to give you an idea. So, let's focus now on the real estate. Actually, digital has been playing a very, very important role in the property market too. And if we look at the four property market websites today existing in Malaysia, this is information courtesy of Comscore, and I think Joe is going to be talking to the panel later. They have about 1 million unique visitors every month. 1 million unique visitors. That's not me going there 3-4 times a day. That's just one person going there once a month. And you can see who they are. So what does it mean? Well, that means it's the equivalent of having an estate agent open 24/7, receiving 1,390 visits per minute. That's big estate agent. So you just try to think. And this is a market that is just beginning. You can start thinking, if you look at the US or if you look at the Australia, you start having a substantial amount of people, over 80% of people that will check a property online, and quite a number of people that will actually start looking and transacting online. And you've all seen the quotation from the newspaper in India about people in India already purchasing houses online. So you think today is not happening, it's true, but why is it not happening? Because they can't. If you give them the opportunity to, they will. So you just need to open those gates and the flood will come. Yet, most of your advertising money, most of your marketing promotion, newspaper. It's still going there. 80% of your money is spent on newspaper. And very few of you, some of you are looking at digital, but very few of you. Only 6% are actively using digital as a promotional tool for their properties and their projects. So you can see that all of your customers are staring at their phones from 7:31 a.m. for 1,500 times a day throughout the day, and most of your ads are not seen because they are on the newspapers. So you really have to make your ads work far harder, because just doing more of the same and expecting a different result, that's what Einstein defined as insanity. So just doing all the same, it's not going to work. You've got to make your ads work harder, because guess what? Ads can sell. Ads should sell, and technology can help you there. So the real question is not why digital. The real question is, how long will you continue to waste money? Marketing is there at hand. So help is there. So enter programmatic, which rightly pointed out is not problematic. Programmatic is a quite fancy term to explain new technology being thrown at digital marketing to help generate far better results. The problem about programmatic is that, as you might have experienced yourself, is usually quite difficult to understand. So what I like to do in a minute or so is just try to simplify that for you and make you understand what it is. I think we have a problem with the sound. Okay.
The first thing you need to know about ad tech is programmatic buying. Over $10 billion will be spent through programmatic over the next year. But do you even know what that is?
No, but it sounds really boring.
Well, it might be boring, but it's actually really important. You see, programmatic buying is the process of executing media buys in an automated fashion through platforms such as trading desks, ad exchanges, and demand-side platforms. The method replaces traditional use of manual RFPs, negotiations, and insertion orders to purchase digital media. You got that?
Are you speaking English?
All right, let me explain it another way. It's like buying stocks on E-Trade as opposed to having to call your broker and having her execute the trades for you.
So it's just buying ads to computers instead of people?
Well, kind of, but it's much more complicated than that.
So, if I wanted the new iPhone 6 for Christmas, instead of writing a letter to Santa and sending it all the way to the North Pole, it'd just be like buying it on eBay?
Well, yeah, I mean, pretty much.
Why'd you make it so complicated? Even an 8-year-old can understand.
This video was made possible by the mobile majority.
Okay, so you kind of got it. I got it only when I saw the video. It might be boring, but it's actually important. Programmatic is just a way, an automated way of buying media. So we use computers rather than humans for buying it. Which basically means that it can be much more efficient. Because, for example, you don't have to plan and buy all the media in one go and then execute the advertising. Everything happens in real time. So even the spending of media happens in real time. And because it happens in real time, and because we have information about the people that are actually seeing your ads, we can place the ads at the right time, in the right context, and to the right people. So you can really, really focus who you're setting your messages to. And furthermore, most importantly, actually, that process can be improved upon. So we can optimize the process, which basically means we can stretch your dollars much, much further. Because if I figure out that if I target somebody like you, you respond to the ad far more, I will basically put more of my money into targeting somebody like you and less of my money into targeting somebody that is not as responsive to my ad as it should be. And in fact, talking about targeting, I've got another quick video which I'd like to show you about what does mean to you audience targeting and why this technology allows that.
This video was made possible by the mobile majority.
So now that you know where ads are bought and sold, it's really important to understand how to get them in front of the right audience. You don't want to buy all the ads on the internet. You only want to buy them in front of the people you want to reach.
Okay. Let me see if I get it. Audience targeting is kind of like Match.com.
No, it's nothing like Match.com.
Oh yeah, it is. That's where I met my girlfriend.
You're kidding me.
Nope. When I created my profile, I didn't want to see all the girls. I was looking for a girl between 3'8", 4'2", and age 10, 11.
You know, I never really thought about it like that, but yeah, you pretty much nailed it. Match.com, huh? I'm striking out on plenty of fish.
It's all about the depth.
This video was made possible by the Mobile Majority.
So you kind of get in the deal, yeah? It's no point in advertising to the wrong people on the wrong media. You want to have the right media, and increasingly the right media is on their phones. It's definitely a digital media. You also want to use technology to your advantage to actually start delivering the right message to the right people and making sure that they see it and they notice and they act on it. Because once you do that, then marketing can start selling for you. And that's exactly what you want. So can it be done? Does it work? Can it be done? Yes, it does. So we have worked, for example, with one of your peers in Thailand, AP Thai, and they actually sell luxury apartments. They sell all sorts of luxury properties. And we worked with them to try to develop digital campaigns. And what happens is that people don't really buy a multi-million dollar property on a whim. They usually think about it. And when they do that, it's very important to stay front of mind so that they keep on remembering that there is that property of yours, that's something that they've been thought of, they find it attractive. So you need to really try to understand what is the journey that these people go through from when they first become aware of your property, in fact, actually from when they first start thinking about buying a luxury property to when they become aware of your property, when they start considering alternative solutions. How do you make sure that you're always front of mind, you're always there blinking, making sure that at the end of the day they select you? So what we've done, we've worked with them to start collecting loads of data about some of the people that were looking at their properties and looking at their advertisements and understood what sort of behaviors they demonstrated. You know, what were their preferred locations when they were looking for certain properties, what was their budget, what are some of their demographics, and so on. And as we have collected these data, we could optimize the campaign, making sure that we were showing to certain people that fitted the right location, the right budget, and the right age more often, so that we would drive in leads. The results, we had an increase of 1,200% on the lead generation, on people that registered to visit the showroom and show the active interest on the property. And why did we achieve that? Because we showed the right ads to the right people at the right place. So where do you start? If you're convinced, as I am, that this is the way forward, and you being in the room today, I don't suppose that all of you were brought here kicking and screaming. So if you are convinced that this is the way forward, where do you start? Well, you need to ask yourself a number of questions. So the first question is, do you or somebody in your team really understand and has a clear idea of what digital can do for you today? The second question is, can you rely on your agencies or your current partners to really push the envelope, to keep you ahead of the game? Or are they just giving you the same old plan? How much of your budget this year is allocated to digital, and how much is simply a rehash of what used to be last year's budget? Do you have 100% visibility over your own marketing ROI? Is your marketing generating sales or not? do you take decisions on the basis of guts, or do you use data? And then the final question, is marketing really moving sales? With that, food for thoughts, I thank you. And I don't know if we have any time for questions. Thank you. Do we have time
on the
for questions?
Stage first, we really have time. We are very, very early, you know. That would mean we're going to have a very long coffee break. Yeah. Either that. So I suggest if there's any questions where you would like to seek clarity or content, he would be able to assist you now. I think we not all of us are very digital savvy. Particularly myself, I'm only digitally 10 days old only, although I'm 57. And there are many terminology, jargons that I'm not familiar with. Words like cookies, to me, was always aimless. And that audiences was actually a bunch of people sitting in a cinema with a Coke and popcorn in their hands. Is it? And digital marketing, to me, was buying four digits over the weekend. And later on, you see some slides about ecosystem. Again, ecosystem is to me a place where plants thrive and animals run around with it. Okay? But later on, you will have the benefit of some of the experts here who will illuminate you with all this terminology, and you probably realize that it's already very much part of our lives, is it? Actually, I'm not very, what you call, technical with technology, but actually, only in recent days, I'm surprised, I realized that I actually have embraced technology. I actually have a pacemaker in my body for the last 40 years, you see. Without that, I would not be here. I'm actually a Terminator. I'm sent from the future to the current time here to illuminate you. How the society and the world actually now operates on, is it? It's fully digital from where I come from, year 2025. All right. Is there any questions that you like to pose to Mr. Ricardo here regarding his slides or any content that you need to seek clarity on? It's okay, you know, any basic questions, because probably the questions you ask may be those answers that I like to hear. So please take the opportunity to ask him.
My question is, you showed a slide that reflected people are spending still a big chunk of their money on print.
Yeah,
80%. Now, in print, it relates to media buying. And in media buying, I associate with the advertising agencies who advise the developers how best to execute their campaigns. Is it possible that the lack of take-up on digital marketing because of poor advice from advertising agencies?
I'm going to take this question. I don't leave it to Pete, because otherwise...
please speak freely. You know, we didn't invite any advertising agency here.
But quite frankly, I think the frank honest is yes. Agencies have been catching up on digital, and there are some agencies that are more digital savvy, some that are less digital savvy, but they are still, the model that they have still locks them in with specific media, so then themselves have commitments with publishers, and sometimes they need to fulfill those commitments at your own expense. But some other times you have more wise agencies that would perhaps consult with us. In fact, we have very close ties with many agencies, and it's more of a consultative approach. So sometimes they come back to us, they say, what do we do? Then we push some ideas towards their way, and then hopefully these ideas trickle back to you. But I think that the reality is, as you look at different sectors, they will probably, there are a number of factors. Some will be they don't want to take too many risks, because I think that it takes a lot of guts from them to come back to you and push your envelope and start saying, let's go all digital, and then maybe the campaign is not executed properly. Then what do? You go back to them and you fire them. So they just take the safe option and say, let's go newspaper. So one is a little bit risk factor. Second one is the commitments that they have in terms of media buying. And third one is about their knowledge about digital. Some of them are catching up. Some others are willingly to learn, but some others are stuck in the past too. And this is where the Googles and the Facebooks are a little bit taking all the market by storm. But it doesn't mean that they are bad. I think that the fair challenge that you can throw at them is you say, well, I've been to this conference. I heard that the future is digital. What do you think? So you might even just be removing the first problem, which is the risk, because at that stage they might even say, look, I actually wanted to be, I wanted to talk to you about that for the longest time, but I didn't know whether you were ready or not, but now that you're ready, let's try.
Yep, thanks.
So we go just in line, yeah?
Okay, we go in line. Basically, I have a confession to make. All buying decisions are by my wife. So, in the case of shopping,
raise your hands if you buy decisions.
In the case of shopping, my wife preferred to feel the texture of whatever she's want to buy, mm-hmm. rather than to look at visual.
Yep.
So how do you solve this problem? Because the wife is not very savvy with digital.
Yeah.
And yeah.
Yeah. So the two things don't exclude each other. Newspapers are still part of the puzzle. You remember one of my earliest slides I was saying, digital is a piece of the puzzle. But the problem is that puzzle has become very fragmented. So we've got TVs, we've got newspapers, we've got radio, we've got applications. So everything is growing in complexity. So if your wife likes the texture, it's good. Need to continue to advertise on that media, but your wife will also be exposed to all sorts of other medias. And the point is, because of all this exposure to various channels, that's how you manage to stay front of mind. If you just focus on one piece, they might never reach your advertisement, because they've been exposed by other media somewhere else, and these media has led them to different places. The other thing to be said is that the young generation, the up and coming, the late 20s, the early 30s, they have gone far more digital than personally I have. And these people have got certain expectations. So as I was saying before, they might as well see an ad of a property on a newspaper, but they will definitely go online. And once they are online, if they don't have the opportunity to start booking a visit, to do these sort of things online that they're used to do, they are faced with a choice. Either they need to go back to the newspaper, check the phone number and call you up, or they will be attacked by all of your competitors that have gone online digitally, and they will drag them around. Because if I'm going to your property, but as I come to your property, I start searching, and then I receive your competitors' advertisements, and then I click on that, then you have lost them. Because the only way you can win them back is if they go back to the newspaper, they remember where they've left it, they find the right page, they call the number, and then they fix an appointment. You need both. They don't exclude each other, but it's part of the mix. Today, your mix is it's a little bit unbalanced. Today, your mix is 80% newspaper. And it's a relatively costly media as well, because digital is far, far cheaper. And
how would you relate that to property?
Well, yeah, my past has been in. I've done a lot of branding in my life, and I'm not a big advocate of discounts. I know a lot of people are building this discount to try to drive attention and clicks and engagement, but the reality is that it works. It works for certain segments. Let's say if you are a Lazada or Zalora, you might want to drive a lot of that because you're fundamentally competing with retail. But I think if you are in the property segment, you can probably still want to build your brand and the value of the intrinsic value of the property rather than engaging into a price negotiation from the first banner. But the reality is that at the end of the day, digital can allow you to do both, and you can do A/B. It's called A/B testing, so you can actually start understanding which one clicks through, and it might turn out that certain creatives, even without the discount, receive more interest from people. So it's really the data, it's not the guts, that determines how effective your marketing is being spent.
Please.
Hello. No. Shall I do it again?
We can do it offline.
We have time now. He can run the slides again.
I don't want everybody to fall asleep when I talk. Anyway, could you share your experience? My understanding of digital marketing is that a good digital agency can point you in the right direction. But the ability to acquire quality response, right, would depend very much on the creative content of the digital ad.
Yeah.
As an owner, how do I ensure that, you know, what, where do I go to? How do I ensure that I get the right quality content?
Yeah. Okay. No, it's a very good question. Yeah. So we explained before that in terms of the buying of the placements, computers do most of the decisions, and they make decisions on the basis of what works and what doesn't work. They try to do more of what works and less of what doesn't work. But creative does play a very, very important role. So I can be placing the right ad at the right time. It's about the subject that really interests me, is positioned quite visibly, but the creative simply doesn't attract attention. People will not click it. So it's still part art, part science. The creative element is very important. So that said, there are a few considerations. Historically, agencies have been gearing up their creative minds towards the traditional media, TV, print, and sometimes they come to us saying, "Oh shit, we didn't produce anything for banners, can you help us?" And so we're doing a last minute rehash of whatever they produced to make it work on digitally. And that's not ideal. But increasingly agencies are understanding that there is a digital environment and there are best practices to be applied for digital. So the first answer to your question is there are best practices. They've been documented by a number of firms like Contrashift and some of our peers, and it's simply on the basis of, okay, banners that have a certain size, banners that carry a certain color. So for example, if you have a human face, you generally drive higher clicks than if you don't have a human face, that sort of stuff. So you have a catalog of best practices that you can go back to your agency and say, have you thought about those? The second thing that I would recommend is creative is important, but machines can also help with the creative. So what we have, there is technology that is called dynamic creative optimization. And what this technology does is presents different images with different messages, with different positions all over. So it presents different permutations of a campaign. And as a certain configuration of that campaign, let's say a certain picture of a certain property with a certain tagline, that one receives more clicks, then he optimizes and starts using that creative more often rather than another one. So I would say that the short answer to your question is, make sure that your agency uses best practices in developing digital content, not just a newspaper ad rehashed for digital. They need to use best practices for digital, and make sure that they present you with options, and then you let the machine optimize the options. So no more guts.
Thanks.
Any more questions? Oh, yes, Dr. Othman.
Thank you. For property developers, some of us track and test and measure the cost of acquiring a lead, mm-hmm. or cost of acquiring sales. And
yeah.
So, you know, for instance, Bunting will cost us about 16 ringgit per lead, or yeah. Newspaper. And would you have statistics on the different approach under digital marketing that gives some sort of indication of what will be the cost of acquisition of leads and
cost of acquisition for property market?
For the leads and sales, you know, because some leads, sometimes you get a lot of leads, but the quality is not so good. Like when we do telemarketing, then you know you have lots of leads, but probably only 2% of them we convert into sales.
So we definitely have the cost for the case study that I presented, but I'm afraid I'm not at liberty of specifically referring to that. But it might not be relevant for you as well, because this was specifically aimed at certain segments. So it might vary if you have a lower end property from when you have a higher end property. In general, for the market, well, Malaysian market, I don't really have the costs because pretty much nobody's doing it. And in the region as well, it's something that is just being picked up by a few players that are a little bit ahead of the game. But there are a few things I can say. Digital is cheaper than the broadsheets, and it's also far more effective in terms of spending, because you're fundamentally very targeting to very, very specific people. And the other thing is that we can do is we can track it down to, particularly with the integration with the sales platforms that Property 365 has, we can actually track it down to the sales, to the very last mile when the transaction happens. So in terms of managing the leads, that can be very extremely transparent.
Thank you.
There was a question up there.
Yes.
Hi. Yeah, before maybe fatigue sets in, if you keep bombarding consumers with advertisements online, you know, when does the yield drop typically in the property?
Again, it very much varies. There are so many contributing factors. But first and foremost is really what it is that you're selling. So if you're in an e-commerce environment, you can be, we call that frequency. So there is a certain frequency that you can put in terms of how many times you can show the same ad. And there are various techniques. So for example, I first show you a first ad. Then as you're looking at it the second time, I show you a different one, and you start telling a story that usually makes them interested. So the straight answer is it varies. There isn't a fixed number. But the solution is also at hand used by using technology and data. So what the computers do, they optimize in terms of frequency. So if they see that, for example, when I show you the same ad 15 times, you click less often, or you sign up for a visit less often, then they reduce the frequency. Then they distance the frequencies a little bit more. But if they also see that if I show you the ad only three times, then you don't sign up for a visit, then maybe they increase it. So the computers optimize the frequency to make sure that whatever it is that you're selling in the right industry drives the outcome that you're looking for.
Thank you.
You mentioned earlier about how discounts and promotions work well for sites like Lazada and Amazon and whatnot, which are pretty much like small ticket items, FMCGs and all that. So in your experience and based on historical data and trends and all that, what are like the best way or the most efficient way to sort of to drive leads and engagement for big ticket items like property?
So the specifically for property, I think that your best asset is to try to replicate a little bit what it is that happens in the real world. So when you have somebody coming up to a showroom or coming for a visit, there is a huge amount of information that you're capturing from that customer just by observing the behavior. The way they're dressed, whether they come with their wives, whether they come with their mistresses, they have kids, they don't have kids. There is a huge amount of information that you can capture around them that will help you qualify the lead, will make you understand whether they can be interested in that property or maybe another property in your portfolio, and what's the price that they might be willing to pay. So how much discount you need to produce, plus a whole sort of other information that you might infer from conversing with that person. Online, all of these things can happen too, because we can start collecting data around their behaviors, what it is that they're looking at, how they interact with the websites, where they live. So we don't, just falling short of knowing their full name, address, and phone number, and actually email and phone number is increasingly becoming a blurred line, we pretty much know everything else. Who they share stuff with, who their friends are, and really what they're interested in. So that can really help you qualify the type of audience that you want to advertise in. So by the time, if you collect all of these crumbles of data, and that's why it's called cookie, because it leaves crumbles throughout your visits, then you are in a situation like if you were in the real world, where you can make a lot of good choices around what it is that I'm trying to sell at this person and at what price. And all of these the computers can do, because they can have that blindingly fast processing power to help you make those decisions.
Thank you.
I'm Raymond.
Yes.
From your earlier, you have shown that the phone itself compared to the Apollo, the power that's inside the phone and CPU processing, right? Yeah. So I believe even the big Microsoft, they are promoting mobile, think mobile and moving towards the mobile direction. Yeah. And if the mobile direction is there, then I think mobile strategy should be the way going forward. And is it why do, I believe in UK is already very well ahead in terms of mobile strategy.
Yeah.
So why do we refer to digital? Is that because the environmental are not suitable at this moment of time or in our country?
Is your question why we use digital why do we
have a portal? Is it? It could straight goes to the apps in Android and in Apple. And you deliver through mobile.
Yeah.
You bypass the browser, is it? So you leapfrog the entire space of delivering, is it? And you still obtain the objective, is it? Yeah. So why reinvent this, is it? I was just thinking, is it? Maybe.
Yeah. Good question. As I was saying before, I think we really need to be looking at it as a puzzle. So it's not either or. I think you just want to broaden your options and start using a different mix. When we go back 200-300 years, people only used newspapers. And then radio came about. And then it took a while to finally convince companies that they needed to start advertising on radio as well as newspaper. And then TV came about, and that added to the mix. And basically, that's where we are today. We're talking about it digital in the broader sense. But even within digital, we have a huge amount of complexity. And this is why, really, a lot of people feel intimidated by digital, because TV was kind of number of channels, number of slots, and that size of the advertisement, and that was kind of it, you know, the classic GRPs. But in digital, we start talking about, okay, do we do social or do we do search? Do we do video or do we do mobile? Do we do search over mobile? Do we do in-app or do we do mobile? There are huge amount of complexities that if we ask a media planner of an agency to work out all of the lines, possible lines and permutations of how your campaign should be executed, this person will take years to work out. And that's why we leave it to the machines to do. So the machines, they will start optimizing between whether it is an advertisement being placed on inside an application or whether it's on the browser. And whether if it is on the browser, it is a browser of the mobile, or is it a desktop, or is it a tablet? So the machines, they look across all of these possible permutations, and they select and they buy the advertisement placements according to where you get the biggest bang for the buck.
Because I thought now the converging of the hardware is moving to the direction of tablets and smartphone.
Yeah.
If you look at the latest indication, smartphone and the PCs are actually coming down, is it? So I think thought that would be a mobile itself would be a better strategy, you know?
Yeah. So as I was saying, I think you're spot on. Mobile. I agree with you. We should be starting thinking first mobile, then digital, because mobile is fundamentally playing the biggest impact on our lives. So if somebody comes to you just with a digital strategy that does not include mobile, you can just fire that person, because you do want mobile to be part of your mix. But you don't want only mobile. Like you don't want to completely give away newspapers. You don't want to completely give away all of the other channels that you use. You want to realize, like you did, that mobile is playing a very important role in the lives of our potential customers. It's a great window, and therefore we want to use it. And as you do that, you also realize that there is a huge amount of complexity that we can deal with. It's taken away from you, because the machines will optimize whether it's mobile, whether it's tablet, whether it's desktop. And within these platforms, whether it's search, whether it's display, all of those decisions are made in real time by the machines. So I think the biggest step you guys need to do is to come to the realization, mobile is important, we need to advertise on digital channels. How the mix of these digital channels is going to be allocated, let the machine do that work, because they can do it in real time, they can do it blindly fast. Any more
questions?
Okay, I think they deserve their coffee.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Ricardo Ottolenghi, for overstaying on the platform here to answer all your questions.